Welcome. Thank you all for being here. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Jason Jewell. I chair the Humanities Department here at Faulkner, and I'm very happy to welcome you to this event where we're hosting Dr. Jay Richards of the Catholic University for America and the Discovery Institute, which some of you may be familiar with. Dr. Richards will be speaking to us in just a moment. Before he does, I'd like to remind all of you, please, to silence your cell phones and other electronic devices so we won't be interrupted during his presentation. I'd also ask, because we probably will still have some folks coming in, you guys in the balcony, if you wouldn't mind, scoot towards the wall on whatever row you're sitting, because if folks trying to come in up there, they need some seating space. I'd appreciate that. Thank you. Our event this afternoon is being sponsored by our friends at the Institute for Humane Studies at George Mason University. The IHS, as it's called, is a great institution that has helped us sponsor a number of events here on the Faulkner campus, events for our students. Two of their representatives are here with us today. If you're interested about various opportunities for students that IHS can provide, which include things like scholarships and summer seminars and other sorts of activities, please say hello to them before you leave today and get some information from them. If you'd like to check out their website, it is theihs.org. I will mention that again at the end of the presentation. And we'll also be asking you at the end to fill out a survey about this event today. But I'm very pleased now to introduce to you Dr. Jay Richards, who, as I said, is a professor at Bush School of Business at Catholic University of America. He's also a senior fellow at the Discovery Institute. He is the author of many, many books, all of which you should read, but the ones that are probably most of interest to the folks here at Faulkner are The Hobbit Party, for those of you who are interested in J.R.R. Tolkien, another book called Money, Greed, and God, which Dr. Richards will actually be talking to us about in tomorrow morning's chapel program. And then finally, The Human Advantage, which is the subject of today's talk. This question of automation in the American economy and around the world has a lot of people asking the question, will robots take all of our jobs? Will there be any jobs left for human beings in the economy in the future? And Dr. Richards is here to answer that question for us. Please welcome him.
Today there was lightning and all the technology just shut off. Right? So yeah, the robots are going to take your jobs until lightning struck. I get asked this question a lot. I've been working on this book for several years, and it was really an attempt to answer this question that's, I think, if anything, become more pointed in the last few years. And it's this question, is a robot going to take my job, or is it an artificial intelligence going to take my job? And when people ask me that about themselves, I usually say, well, what do you do? I mean, this is the question, this is the dilemma. What you might not know is that in the last couple of years, there have been something like 24 books that have been published on this question. And I'm gonna summarize these, basically the whole literature on this question of our jobs and robotification and artificial intelligence. This is a summary. So here is basically half the books say this. Sometime in the next 5 to 30 years, at least 50% of all jobs, not just in the American economy, but in the global economy, are going to be destroyed. They're going to be taken over by robots or smart machines, and that's going to leave at least half the population with nothing to do. It's going to lead to a disaster, and so we need the government to give everybody a universal basic income because they need to get paid, and we're not going to be able to pay them to do something, so let's just pay them not to do anything. All right, so that's the dystopian side of the debate. Now, so here's the other side of the debate. Sometime in the next 5 to 20 years, 50% of all jobs globally are going to be destroyed either by robots or strong artificial intelligence, leaving us with nothing to do. The government ought to pay everybody a universal basic income since we won't have jobs. And it's going to be awesome. That's the whole literature right there. I'm just giving you in 1 minute that you don't have to read those two dozen books. Now notice, okay, so that's the utopian vision. So one is dystopian. We're not going to have any jobs because the machines are going to take them all. It's going to be awful. The other is that machines are going to do all the awful work and we're not going to have to work. And so it's sort of like the vision that Marx had of the future communist utopia, in which you'd be able to say fish in the morning and read literature in the afternoon and maybe smoke and spend time with your family reading in the evening. Just this kind of preternatural utopia in which people could do anything they wanted to do, because the machines, because of the Industrial Revolution, would have become so productive that nobody would need to work. And then during socialism, all the wealth produced in the industrial capitalism would be distributed evenly to everyone. And so you'd get this communist utopia. It's basically the same vision, but it's a kind of techno-utopian vision. Now, I actually think both of these visions are dystopian, whichever side you take. The idea that a large segment of the population would literally not have work to do, that sounds nice for about 3 weeks, but if you look at how people normally, in the normal sort of course of their lives, especially adults between the ages of, say, 20 and 65, how they derive their happiness and fulfillment, this side of glory, it's involved primarily in one of about three things: religious affiliation and religious participation, the bearing and the raising of children, and the production and creation of value, work. If you want to know what causes depression, especially among men, just pull up a map of long-term unemployment in the United States. And then pull up a map of long-term opioid addiction. And overlay those two maps, they look almost exactly the same. The same places. Work is a way in which we fulfill our destiny on this earth. And that's why we should believe this as Christians. We often will think, well, work is really, it's the result of the fall. That's not what Genesis 1 says. Remember when God creates the man and the woman on the encore of day six of the creation? Right, he creates the land animals during the daytime. And then there's this encore where he stops and he speaks to himself. It's totally different from the rest of the text. He says, creates man and woman and speaks to himself. He says, let us make man in our image after our likeness. And he creates them and he tells them, he blesses and commands them, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth and subdue it. And then later, remember, he puts the man in the garden to till and to keep it, to work the garden. That precedes the fall. Work precedes the fall. What the fall does is it twists work so that work becomes toil, so that much of our work is futile, so that we might work the soil and there's just a futility in which it doesn't do what we want it to do. But work itself is a part of what it means to be made in the image of God. It's God's first command to us. So as Christians, the idea that we would be in some kind of situation in which literally no one would need to work, it's not only that no one would maybe necessarily do dangerous work, but that literally there would be nothing for us to do. That ought to be a depressing prospect. And so whatever you're thinking about your job, I want you to frame it in that way, because I actually think there's a really important issue at stake here. There's a great document that Pope John Paul II wrote in 1981 called Laborum Exercens. It's just about work, and he sort of summarizes this very nicely. This is the only Pope I'll quote this afternoon, I promise. The rest is going to be technology, but he puts it exactly right. He says, work is a good thing for man, because through work, man not only transforms nature, adapting it to his own needs, but he also achieves fulfillment as a human being, and indeed, in a sense, becomes more a human being. Now think about that for a minute. Of course, it's our nature to be human beings. God makes us that way from the beginning. Nevertheless, part of what it means to be human is to work, to till and to keep the field. And so that's something you have to do, right? It's not something that you can just be. And so there's a sense in which by doing in a particular way, whatever work exactly is, we become more human than we were at the beginning. We become more than we were at the beginning. I want you to remember that, because that's absolutely crucial. Ultimately, that's kind of the key question in this entire debate. Though you wouldn't expect to sort of hear that, unfortunately, in most of the literature. So let's turn to this sort of broader question. And like I said, there are probably 24 books arguing more or less the same thing. There's one very good, if you're going to read one book on this subject, it's probably Rise of the Robots by Martin Ford. And Ford is interesting because he's actually a tech entrepreneur. So he has himself become personally wealthy as the result of technological innovation. And yet he wrote this book in many ways, I think, just to make the case for a universal basic income. I don't know how many of you have heard that term, a UBI. The idea of a UBI is just that the government would essentially cut everyone a check. Whatever the means are. It's not like means-tested welfare. Just everyone gets a check from the government to do whatever you want to do. You can do anything or nothing. This is actually a really hot topic. It's popular on the left, in the middle, on the right. There are libertarians that advocate this, and there are socialists that advocate this. So this is the hot topic. And even though this book is about robots, I'm now convinced he actually wrote the book just to persuade people that we need to have a universal basic income. But here's what he says in this book. This is a sort of summary of his and the general argument. So the shift now underway will ultimately challenge one of the most basic assumptions about technology, that machines are tools that increase the productivity of workers. Instead, machines themselves are turning into workers. Now this is the key point, because if you know anything about history, if you know anything about economics, what you ought to immediately think, and when I'm talking to economists about this subject, they'll usually say, well, this is ridiculous. I mean, of course, any technology that gets invented is going to make some way of working obsolete. Of course, that's what technological innovation and economic growth is all about. When somebody invented a shovel, right, it made it more productive to dig than to dig with your hands. If somebody invents a tractor, that's going to be more productive than digging with a shovel. And so in a sense, if all you know how to do is dig with your hands and somebody invents a tractor, that's going to put you out of a job. That's not a bad thing, because there are going to be other things to do. And so if you think about, for instance, the transition from the agricultural to the industrial economy. So in the United States, that happened over a period of about 150 years. I'm not sure what the statistics are in Alabama, but I know they are nationwide. If you had looked at the American population in 1776, so the time of the American founding, 95% of the population lived and worked on farms. 95%. And the vast majority that did that didn't have any plan B. So it's not like they had a lot of live alternatives. You know what the percentage of the population living and working on farms now is in the U.S.? It's less than 2%. In fact, it's approaching 1% of the population. Now, if that's all you knew, you might think, well, gosh, does that mean that 94% of the population is out of work since 1776? In fact, you could extrapolate all the way back, say, the last ice age and say, well, actually, all of human history is this depressing story of increasing unemployment and poverty, right, as more technology is developed. That's obviously not true. So what's wrong with the argument? This is what's wrong with the argument, is that if you look at what actually happens, some ways of working get displaced. Some things we do become obsolete. But the new or productive way of working brings prices of goods and services down. And when that happens, whole new markets emerge that didn't exist before. So that people do things, new jobs are created that replace and are often much better than the ones that disappeared. So here's the basic fallacy. It's called the lump of labor fallacy. The idea is there's just this fixed amount of work out there to be done, and once somebody's done it all, then there's nothing left for us to do. That just completely ignores economic history. That's absolutely not how it works. But what Martin Ford and others will tell you is they say, okay, that's been true up until now. But information technology is somehow fundamentally different from all these other economic developments. So that now, rather than just making our labor productive, like replacing some ways of working, notice what Ford says. He said, machines themselves are turning into workers. So in other words, they're not just going to replace old ways of doing things, they're going to replace us. That's the key point. That's the key conviction. It's the key conviction if you go to conferences on these subjects on artificial intelligence, that machines are literally going to replace us. And I don't want to sort of steal thunder from the conclusion, but what you will discover in this debate is that you might think you're talking about economics and technology, but more often than not, you're actually talking about philosophy. You're actually talking about questions such as, what is man? What is a machine? Are human beings machines or something else? And if you think we're just machines made of meat, as one robotics professor put it, then that's going to lead you to a particular conclusion, right? If we're just machines and we're just the result of this blind and personal process of Darwinian evolution and we're conscious, Who's to say that if we design machines that are intended to be smart, they won't surpass us and completely replace us? That's the logic. Although, on the other hand, if you don't presuppose that materialistic idea of the human person, then you might suspect, actually, we're not machines. We're something else. Machines are one thing and we're another thing. That actually ends up being the key debate in the background. Sometimes it surfaces and sometimes it doesn't. But just to tell you up front what I think the sort of answer to this is, should you be worried that robots are going to take all the jobs or are going to replace us? Don't buy it. I think the argument is fundamentally flawed. I think we can show this on economic and technical grounds. I think we can also show it philosophically. Here's what I think the sort of key challenge of the information economy is. It's not that we're literally going to be replaced. It's not what's called long-term or permanent technological unemployment. It's something else. It's the pace of change. The radical and increasing disruption in the economy is the thing that we have to take account of. And that's a real cost. So remember that inflection point I described a minute ago from the agricultural to the industrial economy? So I was describing 1776, essentially to 2018, but most of the work had been done by the 1960s. So that was, close to 200 years it took for that transition to take place. It was still very disruptive. My grandfather on my mom's side, his family had a small family farm. They bought sight unseen a farm in a place called Odessa, Texas. My grandfather's earliest memory was on a covered wagon looking at the stars as they traveled over 300 miles from Dallas, what was Dallas, Texas at the time, to Odessa, Texas. Now, if you don't know anything about Odessa, Texas, it's sand. It's just a bunch of sand. You want to grow stuff? This isn't the ideal place. So as soon as they saw it, this is a disaster, they sold it for what they could, and then they moved to a little town in the Texas Panhandle. My grandfather never managed to nail the agricultural economy. He grew up, he drove a truck, he sold melons, he sold hay to cows, fixed trucks, things like this in the 1930s and 1940s, because the reality is all the good farms had already been taken. So people suffered. It wasn't like the transition was easy. Nevertheless, you didn't get permanent long-term unemployment. And in any case, that took place, like I said, over a couple of centuries. Now compare that to our situation. Just in my lifetime, so when I was a really little kid, I grew up in the cassette tape era, but my mom, when they didn't want to invest in that, my mom and dad had LPs, which actually you guys know what LPs are because they've had a comeback, right, with these big vinyl records. And so I grew up listening on a little record player to my mom's Sound of Music soundtrack. So it's kind of embarrassing now that I say it out loud, but that's what I did. So I'm listening to the music on this LP, and then we started doing cassette tapes. But even before that, my dad was interested in this transition technology called 8-track tapes. All right, he had hundreds of dollars invested in the 8-track tape industry. They were terrible. And so they were very quickly displaced by cassettes and then CDs. And so that's kind of when I got on board, buying lots of CDs, had an amazing investment by coming to college. I haven't bought a CD, a music CD, in 9 years. I suspect there's some students here that don't know any. What do we do? How do we transport our music? We transport our music on technology, but we don't actually normally embed them in physical media. Most of our music is MP3 files, it's software. We've moved just in our lifetimes from 4 different forms of transporting and storing music in the world of atoms to storing music in the world of bits, from the world of matter to the world of information. That's the disruption of the information economy. And it means that changes are going to take place very, very quickly. So if you're a student, depending upon what you're doing, don't imagine that you're going to learn everything you need to know in a 4-year education, even here at Faulkner, wherever you are, 4 years, and then that will prepare you for a 40-year job working on this. That's just probably not going to happen. You're at the beginning of a process of continual education in which you'll constantly be learning new stuff. So here's what I want to do in the next few minutes. I want to help you understand, okay, what makes the information economy unique? What actually makes it different from the industrial economy and the agricultural economy? What's it like, right? Because all these smart, officially smart people claiming it's different from all the other economies. And then, given what we know about the information economy, what do you need to do? What do we need to do to prepare ourselves for this age of smart machines? So let me spend a few minutes. First, this is my account and a summary of a burgeoning literature, trying to describe the information economy. Because information, as you can imagine, remember I mentioned the world of bits, the world of information a minute ago. It's different from the world of land and real estate and farms and machines and motors and gasoline. The information economy is quite different. Here are the sort of five main properties of the information economy. Don't worry, I'll define all these words. Disruptive, I've already told you about. That just means things change quickly. There's a lot of creative destruction in which things become popular, they're the next big thing, everybody buys it or does it, and then it becomes obsolete and it's replaced. Exponential refers to the rate at which things grow in the information economy. It's digital. Okay, so I want you to think for a minute about what you think the word digital even means. It's hyper-connected, you know exactly what that means. And it's ever more informational. So let's not talk about disruptive. I've already told you that. That's basically what I would call the key cost of the information economy. And if you're 18 to 21 years old, you're going to have to deal with this. You're going to deal with this thing. Depending on what you're studying, I have advice for what I think the best thing to do is if you're a student. We can talk about that in a minute if you want to know. But you need to do something that makes yourself, so that you make yourself adaptable, so that you can learn new things on the go. So exponential. Some of you have probably heard the story of Moore's Law. Gordon Moore was a co-founder of the Intel Corporation, which makes the computer chips. But back in 1965, he worked at a place called Fairchild Semiconductor. And he noticed this weird trend, and he wrote a paper about it. And he noticed that about every 18 to 24 months, engineers were capable of putting about twice the number of transistors on an integrated circuit as they had been before. So in other words, imagine, so 1 year you can only put one transistor on, a year and a half later you can put two, and then 4, 8, 16, 32, 64, 128, 256, you see where this is going, right? So not 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, but doubling at every stage, and doubling at a pace of about every year and a half to 2 years. You realize, okay, this is significant, this is exponential growth, essentially in computing power, the brains at the time of what we thought of as computers. And he said at the time, well, this will probably happen for about 10 more years. That was in 1965. This trend of exponential growth in computing power has continued to the present. But what people said, if you read the literature, is they kept saying, Moore, this is called Moore's Law, named after him, this law of accelerating or exponential growth in computing power. So people thought, well, this probably just has something to do with the physical properties of crystalline silica. That's the material that computer chips are made of. There was a guy named Ray Kurzweil that I wrote a book with some years ago. He's now vice president of Google. Now, this is kind of a wacky guy, all right? So he is predicting a moment in about 2043 called the singularity, when technology is going to outpace us, and we're going to have to upload ourselves to the internet so that we don't get left behind. That's his view. I'm not making this up. People used to think I was making this up. He's a vice president of Google, okay? But he's a very interesting guy, and he's had a really good record of predictions. He predicted within a couple of years when the first computer would beat the first master at chess. And it happened when Garry Kasparov was beaten in the 1990s. So he's got a good record on this thing. And he wrote a book in 1998 called The Age of Spiritual Machines. And then in the mid-2000s, a book called The Singularity is Near. In both of these books, Kurzweil thought, okay, wonder if Moore's Law, if that trend happens in other places. And he realized, as he knew computer technology, that actually computing had used five different physical forms just in the 20th century. So those little microprocessors that we're all used to, that's just the last of five physical systems that have been used in the 20th century. And so he decided to say, okay, what would happen if we were to map the trend of how much computer power you could get for $1,000 adjusted for inflation? So he did that across five different forms. So here, it's a little small, you probably can't see it. It's a logarithmic plot, so it's just powers of 10. And so you probably can't see the text. It says electromechanical, so that's where a computer started around 1900. And then a relay system. And then a vacuum tube system, which is what they were using in World War II and afterwards, and then just a simple transistor system, and then an integrated circuit system where you put these transistors on these microchips. And see what he, notice the plot. The trend of exponential growth transcends the physics. Five different physical ways of computing and the same trend. Now that's deeply mysterious. Is it a law like the laws of physics? No, I don't think there's any reason to think that. Now, Kurzweil, if you read him, he describes this as happening everywhere from the history of the cosmos and the history of life and the human race and technology, and he sees it everywhere. So you don't want to oversell this. Nevertheless, if you look at the trends in information technology, what you discover over and over and over again is exponential growth. In fact, in his brand new book, Life After Google, George Gilder points out that storage, just what you might call store width, is vastly outstripping Moore's law. So this trend of doubling of computing power, it's trivial compared to the trend in how much more and more and more we actually store. Same thing is happening with communications, technology, and almost anything you could care to count. It's not happening in energy and physics. It's not happening in real estate. It's happening in the information-dense parts of the economy. And so this is really the reason there's so much disruption, because you've got exponential growth. The second feature of the information economy is that it's digital. Now, I don't know what you think this word means. I admit that when I was in the seventh grade, I thought the word meant a clock that had numbers rather than analog hands, because my dad got a digital watch when we were in the seventh grade. But digital, it actually refers to the language of zeros and ones, or the binary, on and off, black, white, zero, one, whatever contrast you want. That's the native language of computers. Okay, the way it's often described is that digitization is the movement from the world of atoms to the world of bits. The world of material stuff to the world of information. A bit is a measure of information. Right? Now, this is a sort of an odd thing because a couple of weird things happen in economics. So if you're wondering, okay, when do I need to really concentrate during this talk? This is the moment. All right. So I'm going to give you two economic concepts so you can totally check out if you can make it through this. All right. Here's why this matters. Because in informational goods, our new is fundamentally different from normal economic. Normal economic goods have what economists call a non-zero marginal cost, and they are rival goods. Now, what am I talking about? Okay, think about a set of the Encyclopedia Britannica. You can still actually buy a physical set, right? But if I own a set for a couple of $1,000, it takes up space, you have to print it, you have to store it, you have to ship it, it's made of paper and cardboard and ink and things like that. Right? And so you might publish, say, 1 million sets at a time, and so you can get the per unit cost down. Nevertheless, each additional set is going to cost you something, right? Because it's going to take materials. So that's the marginal cost just means the cost of the next thing, the next one that you produce. The other thing is that it's a rival good. And what that means is that if I own a set of the Encyclopedia Britannica, you can't have a set either. Lots of things that we're interested in, cars, girlfriends, generally, right? Pizzas, they're rival goods, right? Everybody can't have these things at once. If I eat this pizza, you're not getting it. The best we can do is kind of divide up each have part of the pizza. Does that make sense? Now think about a subscription to the Encyclopedia Britannica, right? If I get a subscription to the Encyclopedia Britannica online, I don't deplete the store. It's not like, oh, well, there's one less subscription left. Or if I download a song for $1.29 from iTunes, I haven't depleted the store of those things. Moreover, that one MP3 file, once the sub is set up and the electricity and the computer and the network, it's basically zero marginal cost. The actual cost of that single file is basically zero. Yeah, maybe it's 1/100 of a cent or something like that. So you see how different that is? You go from a world in which you have marginal cost, it's always a real cost, and it's rival, so everybody can't have it. If one person has it, somebody else can't have it. To a world in which additional copies of a thing are basically free, and everybody can have it, and the store doesn't get depleted. So you move from a world of scarcities, right, which you're sort of challenging, one person can have this, and so we're going to compete over price, to a weird world of abundance. This is why property law is getting weird and obscure now with digital goods, because it's sort of hard to say, okay, well, it's easy to steal information, right? Once somebody has a copy of it, it's easy to get out. That's digital. And it makes the information economy in many ways fundamentally different from older economies. It's hyper-connected. This is one of these things nobody needs to be explained. If you're a parent like me, this is something that actually irritates you a lot. I've got my daughters, before I was aware of it, I'm a bit of a helicopter parent, I'll admit it, and so I'm basically aware of everything that's happening. But somehow both of my children managed to get Snapchat before I was kind of aware of it, right? And so this is a program for the parents that kids don't have that stop them, where they have to take pictures of themselves smiling in order to send messages, okay? And so it's constantly pestering. It's constantly pestering me, and then so I ended up bribing them, doing deals with them to get off of it. But this is the reality in which we live. The editor of Wired magazine, Kevin Kelly, wrote a book last year called The Inevitable. And in this book he said, people 1,000 years from now will look back on this time in which we live at the beginning of the 21st century as an amazing time, because that was the moment that the entire human race first connected itself to one thing. Already, not completely done, but the vast majority of the human population in principle is connected to each other at roughly the speed of light, roughly simultaneously. That is an absolutely remarkable thing. And the deal has only kind of been closed since 2007. Remember, the first iPhone just came out in 2007. So now that connectivity goes directly to our person, and 5G isn't even here yet. That's a couple of years out. This hyperconnectivity is going to continue to happen. And if you know anything about networking theory, there's something called Metcalfe's Law. It's kind of like Moore's Law. It basically says, a technical way of putting it is that the value of a network goes up as the square of the number of users in the network, which is just basically says the more users you get, the value goes up way, way fast. That's essentially what that means. And so it's often been said that the guy who sold the first telephone is the greatest salesman who ever lived. Right? So think about it. One telephone in the universe. Right? What are you going to do with it? Nobody to talk to. The only value in a telephone is what? If there's somebody else with a telephone, there's a network that connects you, and you want to talk to them, right? Then you can have a conversation from a distance. Now I have one more person. That means there's multiple different conversations that can take place. Add four, and very quickly you get an exponential increase in the types of interactions that can happen between you. Same thing happens in our brains and neurons. That's an exponential increase in the value of a network. That's why networks want to get large quickly. It's why networks say apps, for instance, say traffic apps. You want the app that has the most users on it because the data is coming from the users. You don't want to be the 9th best traffic app on iTunes. Nobody wants that, right? So this is the reason that networks tend to get big. It's because of these network effects. But this is a central feature of our information economy. And then finally, the economy is ever more informational. Now here's the weird point, probably the key point of my talk, and the most difficult. Because now we have to define information. What is it? Most of us think we know what information is. If you look at the sort of history of the word, it is anchored back in a Greek word, eidos, meaning idea, referring to the mind, or informare, right, form. The form in Aristotle, in Greek philosophy, is the thing. What you are. You exemplify the human form. That's what you are. Right? And if you read Thomas Aquinas, he says, well, the form is two things. It's both the thing that you are, that you sort of instantiate as this universal, and it's also the idea in the mind of God. So God from eternity has an idea of human nature, and then he creates humans, all of whom share this universal. That's the form of the thing. Now notice the word again. Information. Right, now, this was not intentional with information theory, but it's already right there in the word. Now, if you know anything about Aristotle, everything in the material world, Aristotle said, is a combination of matter and form. But matter by itself doesn't do anything. Matter is just this kind of amorphous stuff. It's actually the form that makes something what you are. So it's not the matter, per se, the atoms or molecules that make you human. It's your nature as a human being that makes you human. That's the idea of information. It's the information, that form that is in things, that is in matter. But it also means, if you read information theory, that it's not matter itself. This is a really weird thing. Okay, so what are we talking about when we talk about, say, bits of information? This was actually a new insight. It was developed by a guy named Claude Shannon, in the 1950s. He was an information theorist at Bell Labs, and he was basically trying to figure out, okay, how do you measure an information signal, a communication signal that's going across a channel, like a copper wire? And would there be a way to compress this? And he wanted to figure out a way to measure, can you distinguish the noise from the signal and things like that? And he figured out a way to actually measure the amount of information in something. That's what a bit is. And what he said information is for Shannon is basically the resolution of surprise. So the more surprise that's in something, the more information that's in it. So here's the basic idea. Let's say I take a quarter. So if I ever actually use cash, I have a quarter in my pocket and I'd show it to you, all right? So fair quarter, heads and tails. Right, so right now you don't know how it's gonna come down, but you know I'm gonna flip the coin. Right, I flip it, it comes down tails. That's one bit of information. The reason it's a bit, if it was heads, it would also be a bit. So what the information is the collapse from this world of possibility, there were two possibilities, neither of them is actual, to one concrete actuality in heads or in tails as one bit of information. And if I kept flipping the coin and writing down the sequence of heads and tails, that would increase the number of bits of information in the sequence. Now you might notice something weird about this though. That there's a number, you can measure the amount of information in that sequence even if it's random gibberish. The sequence of heads and tails doesn't have to form a pattern. And so there's something weird here when you're using the language of information theory and computers to talk about the information we're actually interested in. Let me give you another example. Let's say you take a sequence from Shakespeare, methinks it's like a weasel. This is English language, right? I could give you the number, the amount of information, the number of bits in that sequence. Now you know that's information, you know it's a meaningful sequence of letters that forms a message, right? Right? Now imagine that I scramble those letters, same length. It has the same bits of information in it, even though it's gibberish. So that tells you that this type of information, what we call Shannon information, it doesn't quite capture what we mean when we're talking about meaningful information. So again, what is information? It's actually easier to tell and to point at than it is in some ways to define. I don't know maybe how many of you have been to Victoria in British Columbia. It's in the sort of southwest part of Canada. Just north of Seattle, it's an island called Vancouver Island, and just on the southern tip is this beautiful city called Victoria that has a double harbor in it. And so if you take a ferry from Seattle or Port Townsend into Victoria, or you take a cruise ship, you pull into the outer harbor, and the water gets very, very smooth. But you keep going, and it keeps getting narrower and narrower, and then you enter an inner harbor. It's so peaceful that the Parliament building, so think of the sort of state of Alabama capital, imagine sticking it right by the ocean. That's what you have in Victoria. That's, you know, maybe 100 yards from ocean. That tells you how placid it is. And if you pull in at night in the summer, it's a beautiful place, but you might not notice there's actually something interesting on the side of the hill in front of the Parliament building. Let me give you a daytime picture. Maybe you can see it. Right there. It's red and yellow begonias. It says, welcome to Victoria. Now, how do you know that's information? You say, well, it's really improbable that, say, you know, Canadian geese flying by just dropped these seeds on the way south and it spelled itself out. It's very improbable. Well, that's true, but you know, any random sequence of seeds that you just threw out would be improbable. It would be very hard to do it more than once. So it can't just be that it's improbable. There's something else going on. What else is going on is that it's not just an improbable arrangement, but it also conforms to an independently given pattern that we have a reason to attribute meaning to. So in this case, you're using your background knowledge. You know English, you know the rules of English language and grammar and syntax. You know that you're in Victoria, and you go in and you know that someone could spell this. And so you immediately detect that this isn't just a random arrangement, right? And it's not just the laws of physics dropping this down, right? The laws of physics require that those seeds fall if you drop them, right? But they don't dictate that they spell anything out. That's the result of intelligent agency. The information theorist Henry Quassler says, we habitually associate the creation of new information with intelligent agents. Another information theorist says, information is not matter or energy, it's some third thing. Here's the key point. The source and the production and the creation of information, whenever we can trace it back, always comes back to the activities of an intelligent being, a being that has purposes and intelligence and agency and freedom. These things might be produced by a machine that's been programmed to do that, but machines themselves don't create new meaningful information in this way. Now, I hope you see why that's important here, because what this means is that in many ways the information economy is uniquely fit to intelligent agents. And so the lesson is essentially that what we want to do, if we don't want to be replaced by robots, is focus on those things that make us uniquely human, that distinguish us as free, intelligent, purposive agents from any machines that we can create. Or as economists would put it, this just means we need to focus on our comparative advantage over machines. Any kind of work that can be automated, either can be automated with a machine, maybe you're doing some highly repetitive process work in an assembly line, or you're doing a piece of office work that just involves simple calculation, those types of jobs are going to be automated. But things that require us to use those things that are uniquely human will not be replaced. In fact, they'll be enhanced. So what does that mean? What that means is that we should focus on the virtues that correspond to those five features of the information economy. Now, what's a virtue? Here's what I'll say, okay, here's basically what a virtue is. A virtue, it draws on the fact that we are free beings. God creates us in his image. We can choose good or evil. We can choose vanilla or strawberry ice cream, right? And because of that, we can act in certain habitual ways. And so let's say we decide to do something right. We decide to focus really carefully on our studies. We do it over and over and over again. It's an act of the will, and then it becomes a habit so that we start to do it automatically. And if we keep focusing on that habit after a while, it works its way back into our will and into our being so that we become more than we were at the beginning. So that we become virtuous human beings and have a capacity we did not begin with. So that's what we want to focus on. So in other words, now, there's some basic virtues you need in any economy. Learn to be punctual. Don't be rude to customers, right? Don't get thrown in jail for felonies. Don't do lots of illegal drugs and get drunk all the time. All right, so those are kind of the basic, you know, sort of necessary conditions for not just having a terrible life. So I'm not talking about those virtues. I'm presupposing those. But in an information economy, there are virtues that actually will optimize you and your work for success. The first is just courage. Remember I told you this, in this economy is highly disruptive. So things change quickly. Jobs and industries, whole industries, come into existence and they flare up and then they disappear. And so that means that you have to be willing to exercise the virtue of acting in the context of and the possibility of failure. So you have to be willing to do things even though you know you might fail. That's important because in the world that's constantly changing, you can't predict the future. And so you might try something that ends up being a bad idea, right? But if the possibility of failure prevents you from acting, you're never going to get anywhere. So you have to be willing to fail. You have to be courageous. Now, this is a virtue we have to cultivate. If you think of, say, Irish immigrants from the early 19th century that came to the United States, they might even think, now, they were courageous. That's true. But for most of them, the choice was starve or be oppressed or get on a boat and go somewhere they've never been before and leave behind everything that they know. So if your options are starve to death, that kind of encourages courage, right? When the options are that limited. None of us are going to starve to death. We might be poor, we might have kind of depressing lives. We're not going to starve to death. And because of that means you actually have to cultivate this ability. It might be that you live someplace where there are no job opportunities, and that requires that you have to actually get up and move someplace where the opportunities are. So that's why you have to cultivate this as a virtue. But courage by itself is not enough. You know, you'll often in business courses, you'll hear, you've got to be willing to fail. It's actually possible to just keep failing. That is not a path to success, trust me. You might just keep failing all the way down the bottom, right? So you need something else. Virtue that Nicholas Nassim Taleb calls anti-fragility. This is after a book called Anti-Fragile. Now, what is anti-fragility? You might think of different kinds of systems. A fragile system or a fragile object, like a crystal vase, is something that's easily, if you perturb it, it's likely to break, right? Even a loud pitch scream might break this crystal. It's fragile. So what's the opposite of fragile? Right? They want something strong or robust, like rebar, right? It's hard to break it. Well, that's kind of the opposite, but it's not exactly the opposite because it's still very brittle, right? You could still, if you really stretch it, you could still break it. There's actually this third property, antifragility. An antifragile system is something that improves with perturbation, that when it's damaged, it gets better than it was before, like this guy. Now, biological systems have this in spades. This is how organisms generally work. If you play the guitar and you've never played the guitar before, in 5 minutes, your fingers are going to be killing you. And if you do it for 10 minutes, they'll bleed. And if you do it for weeks and weeks and weeks, you're going to have hard calluses that are so thick you can play for hours. That's because God has made us so that our biological systems adapt. But it's not just resilience. It's the ability to actually be better than you were before. That's what happens when you lift weights. Now, this guy's obviously been at it for a long time. But when you lift weights, if you do it right, enough time under tension, enough pressure, enough reps, enough weight, you actually tear the muscle fibers. You create an inflammatory response. And then, if you rest, you can't just keep doing this. You could just tear it down. You've got to rest, you've got to eat right, and then what happens is your body repairs it and makes it stronger and bigger than it was before. That's antifragility. Now, what's this have to do with sort of working in the information economy? Antifragility is the ability first to be courageous and be willing to fail, and then to take your experiences of failure and learn lessons from them so that you have something that you can contribute and something you know that you did not know before. So that everything you do is a stack, a new talent or a new experience on top of everything else. Some of you may know who this guy Scott Adams is, a Dilbert cartoon fan. He wrote a book called How to Fail at Almost Everything and Still Win Big, or something like that. It's just about his life. This guy has had more terrible ideas. He wrote a hypnosis book at one time, and just one stupid idea after the other, and lost his money several times. But every so often, he would hit on something, and he even had two bank jobs that were dead-end jobs. And he's actually a very good cartoonist. But he used his banking and office experiences, and he sort of parlayed it into this amazing career as a cartoonist. That's anti-fragility. So courage, anti-fragility. And wait, what do these things have to do with the properties? I forgot. So courage corresponds to what? Disruption. Anti-fragility, that corresponds to exponential growth, because of the speed. Third one is altruism. Altruism is just, that doesn't mean that you necessarily think about and visualize world peace and think about how much you love people. Altruism is just acting for the benefit. And so you might have thought that successful entrepreneurs are successful if they're really greedy and think about themselves. It's not actually true. If you think about the late Steve Jobs, who wasn't all that nice of a person personally, the reason he succeeded is because he could anticipate what people wanted, sometimes better than they could. He could anticipate what they wanted and then bring it about. In a market economy, that's normally how you succeed, is you anticipate what people want and then you find a way to serve them. That's altruism. That's always been important in free enterprise, but it's especially important in an economy that's filled with digital goods. Because that means there's thousands of things that we can create for each other and for other people that could not be created before. Whether it's handmade goods sold on Etsy, or it's workout videos that you simply upload onto YouTube. That's altruism. So just think of this barista here. Right? He may not love these two women or necessarily know their names or be praying for them. Nevertheless, to really be good at what he's doing, he has to be able to serve them and anticipate what they want. That's altruism. Collaboration, which corresponds to hyperconnectivity. Collaboration is a form of humility. Collaboration is the ability and the willingness to learn from and work with others. If you're the kind of person that thinks you already know everything you need to know and everybody else is stupid, right? You're not going to be good at this, right? Everybody else is not stupid. Most of the smart people in the world are outside of any company you work for, any company you own. In Silicon Valley, they say CEOs are constantly thinking that most of the smartest people in the world work for someone else. That's the right attitude. Collaboration, there's a huge amount that you can learn from others, and there's a huge amount that you can benefit from working with others. We now have the capacity to collaborate globally. I run an online news and commentary site from my office in Washington, D.C. with staff all over the country simultaneously. And then finally, creative freedom. What is creative freedom? This is the biggie. This corresponds to information. Remember what I told you information was. Now, you might hear freedom say, okay, what is freedom? I like to ask little kids this. They always say, freedom's getting to do what you want to do. If I can let me play out in the street, or I can just binge watch something on Netflix, I'm free. Okay, that's a type of freedom. This is what philosophers call freedom of indifference, or libertarian freedom. Just the freedom to choose between incompatible alternatives. So think about a little girl whose parents buy her a piano. Say, honey, we've got you a piano here, and you're free to play it whenever you want to. And so she can go in, she can plunk notes on the piano, but she doesn't actually know how to play the piano. She's free to push buttons, but is she free to play Rachmaninoff? Is she free to play Beethoven's Ninth? No. How would she acquire that freedom? She would acquire that freedom actually by constraining herself, not doing whatever she wants to do, but doing very specific things in which she collapses all the fields of possibility into this very focused thing, when she learns her scales, and she learns how to keep beat, and she practices, and she keeps her butt on that bench for years and years and years, and focuses her attention. And then if she does that long enough and constrains herself long enough, she will acquire a freedom that she did not have before. It's not just a mere freedom to do what she wants. It's a freedom to create value, and to create information, in this case, to create music, a capacity that she did not have before. So that is the principal virtue of the information economy. The weird thing about the sort of age of intelligent machines is that it creates a false consciousness for human beings. We make these amazing technologies that can imitate the types of things that we do. Whenever you do a Google search, it's eerie how good it is. And yet we make these machines, and rather than saying, we are not just Homo sapiens, we are Homo Faber. We are man, the maker of these machines. Instead, we demote ourselves and we attribute intelligence and meaning to the machines themselves. We really should flip that over. When we see these machines, we shouldn't be terrified of them. We shouldn't worry that Skynet is going to wake up suddenly and become conscious and take over. We should, if anything, be amazed at this capacity that God has allowed us to fulfill. Thomas Aquinas said, God grants to creatures the dignity of causality. In other words, God doesn't hoard creative potential all into himself. He creates sand, and he allows us to create fiber optic cables and computer chips that are made of sand. So when you look at technology, don't fear it. Prepare and weigh the costs and benefits. But I hope it will remind you of simply what it means to be made in the image of the Creator God. Thank you very much.
And we're going to have a few minutes for folks to ask questions from the audience. If you would like to ask a question of Dr. Richards, please come back here where I'm standing, and we'll form a line of microphone, and you can ask a question of him. While some of you are genuine up the courage to do that, one of the things that you're supposed to develop in this company, right, the courage, I will ask Dr. Richards a question. You mentioned earlier that you might have some suggestions for 18 to 21-year-olds in the audience about things they might wish to study. We have representatives of the design departments here at the university here. What should students be thinking about trying to learn while they're in the university setting? What should faculty be thinking about how what we should be imparting to students?
People often think that because of an information economy, they imagine that the only people that are going to have jobs are going to be computer engineers. Now, if you're in computer engineering, good choice, because you're going to probably have a job if you do well at it. So there's no doubt that that's a growth area, but that's really a sort of false idea. It would be like imagining that in the industrial economy, everybody was going to work in factories and on machines. But in fact, if you think about it, the more advanced the industrial economy became, the fewer and fewer people actually work with mechanical machines. In the same way, what's actually going to happen is that many of the things, if you think about it, because we're both spiritual beings made in the image of God, but we're also physical beings, right, that have animal properties. And so we can carry things just like a horse can or an ox can. And so there are many things that we're still doing just simply with simple repetitive bodily movements that are going to be handed over to machines. And so what that means is that they're going to be things that it's sort of counterintuitively won't ever sort of be displaced. So you might think, let me give you an example of physicians. So right now what's happening is that it's a computer by IBM called Watson that's doing a better job of diagnosing illness than probably any diagnostician anywhere. All right, so you might think, well, that's going to replace doctors. You want to know something though? If you are diagnosed with stage 4 cancer, you don't want a machine to tell you that. And so what's actually happening is that people skills and emotional intelligence for physicians is becoming more and more and more important. And the technical skills, and you still got to know what you're doing, right? But the technical ability to diagnose ends up being less important, and the human, the personal, ends up being more important. Marketing and managers, right? The job, the ability to organize people creatively, that's still a very, very important thing to do. The other thing is there are actually a lot of physical labor jobs that we are a long ways from replacing, having robots replace. So if you're doing something repetitive in a factory, that's something we can make a machine to do. If you're doing something that involves complex bodily movement, landscaping, housekeeping, painting, carpentry, we don't have many machines that can do that. It's called Moravec's paradox. We can't make a robot that can do the things that any three-year-old can do with his hands. Because we have all these complex feedback saying, okay, this is a piece of glass, this is a toilet paper roll, this is a heavy machine, this is a laptop. We can tell the difference. If you look at the robots we make, they're very good at doing exactly the same thing over and over. So what that means is that the people skills and the complex bodily movement skills, the know-how skills, those are going to rise. So what does that mean for college students? Here's basically my argument, is that if you have a choice about what to study, first of all, get the general skills. Because the really technical skills, you might think, okay, I'm gonna study actuarial science, which might be good, but it might also be obsolete in 5 years. If you don't know how to write a sentence, though, you should do that. We at the Bush Business School, we ask business executives, okay, what do you need from our students? Over and over they say, give us somebody who can write a coherent sentence. So become numerate, become logical, right? Become coherent in your writing. Do those things, and then also develop a couple of specialties on the side. Maybe you take a coding boot camp, maybe you take a class, graphic design course, or you do an internship in social media or something like that, so that you kind of mix it up. So anybody that can develop a broad-based liberal arts education so that you're coherent and you're literate, and then also develop as kind of side gigs some technical skills, even though those are likely to change over and over. That's what I advise people. That's what I advise my children. I can call on people at random, Jason.
We should do that. Comes up one question. Briefly, you mentioned Moore's law and
yes.
The rate of transistors on a microprocessor. Recently, Intel has been having trouble getting past their 14 nanometer process.
Yes.
Do you believe Moore's law is finally concluding? And if so, how will that affect artificial intelligence?
I don't actually think Moore's law is concluding. I think what's happening is that we're reaching the physical limits of this particular technology. And so I think the age of the integrated circuit is coming to a close. I think what's likely to happen is that we're going to transition into something like photonics or quantum computing, which is just now coming online. But part of the reason for this is that in some ways, if you just focus on Moore's law and computing power in the microprocessor, it causes you to overfocus. And so for a long time, the way networks were set up, the way the sort of internet architecture was set up is that you wanted to have computers that were very, very powerful and faster out on the edges. But with cloud computing, actually, the computational speed and power of your computer is no longer all that important, right? In fact, I use most of my graphic design apps are actually on the cloud. And so there's no pressure, actually, on microprocessor speed is not what it always was. Now it's actually network speed and things like that. So what's actually happening is the places that are abundant, say network speed and store width, that's where all the growth is taking place. And I think that's partly because we're reaching the physical limits of processor speed. I don't expect it to end, but I do expect us to end up using some physically different system sometime in the next 10 years or so. Because you eventually just reach the scale of atoms, obviously. Yeah.
Dr. Richards, you mentioned other people's predictions of when robots will replace
humans.
Do you have an idea of your own on that, or will it happen at all?
So So I don't think robots will ever replace humans, because I don't think robots are machines and we're not machines. And so they're two qualitatively different things. They will replace many of the things that we are doing. And I'd say the best way to tell is set aside things that involve complex bodily movement. Those aren't going anywhere anytime soon. And then look at what's actually happening. So long-haul trucking, for instance, I think that that is in deep trouble. So in many states, I don't think it's true in the South, but in some of the Western states, the number one job for males is still long-haul trucking. Technology already exists to automate this. The technology already exists for simple autonomous vehicles on simple tracks. And so things like that. So like Uber driving and Lyft driving, that's great right now, but just about the time that Uber and Lyft displace the taxi industry, the Uber and Lyft drivers are probably going to get displaced by autonomous Uber cars. So those kinds of things. And then the types of factory work that involve assembling lines that don't involve complex work. There will continue to be factories and assembling lines in which trained technicians will be involved in complex activities. But there's a famous scene, you look at it on YouTube, in Lucille Ball, where Lucy and her friend are in this chocolate factory, right? There's a belt going by. All they're doing is wrapping these things. Nobody, those jobs aren't going to exist. So if a city is built around the assembly line construction that's quite simplistic, that was invented by Henry Ford. That is a 20th century artifact that will disappear. And so I would expect all of those kinds of jobs to disappear. And so if people are doing those kinds of things, I advise them, look, be training yourself. Don't quit prematurely, but train yourself, because those are going to disappear. Don't imagine that means all the jobs are going to disappear, just those types of jobs. And new ones that we can't yet anticipate will replace them.
Thank you.
Sure.
Before we go to our next question, Burgess, could you put up a slide for the survey?
Oh, yes, sorry, let me pull this up. So, actually, can you guys read this? So this is the Institute for Humane Studies, which sponsored this talk. So if you would answer the survey here, I don't know if you can see that URL. It's tinyurl.com/yc4uelag. You fill out a survey for the
students. You might want to take a picture of that slide with your phone and then you magnify it so you can see it. Please fill out that survey so our friends at the IHS will get that feedback. Again, we still have time for one or two more questions.
Hi. So my question is, do you see any biblical evidence for God's plan for the future of information technology?
I wish there was something in Scripture. I don't know of anything in particular. I do think, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth and subdue it. So the idea that the earth ought to be filled with human beings. I mean, it's completely contrary to the kind of contemporary idea that the best earth is one in which there are no humans doing anything. Now, obviously, we're fallen, and so we can despoil and destroy the earth as well. That's not what God wants us to do. He gives us the dominion or the stewardship of the benevolent heavenly king. And so I actually think that just the fact that we are continuing to informationalize the physical order is itself a kind of manifestation. Now, we can informationalize it in a good way or in a bad way. But what we're doing is, if you look at the way in which wealth is created, more and more and more of the wealth that's created in advanced economies takes place in the world of mind and in the world of information. And so the resources that we take for, integrated circuits and fiber optic cables are the perfect example. Nobody thinks of sand or silica as a natural resource, right? It's one of the most abundant elements on the Earth's crust. It's not anything you'd think of as having value. And yet, look at what we can do with it. Or two Blu-ray discs. One is blank. One has a unique copy of Microsoft Office. I'm assuming you can get it on a Blu-ray disc, right? But they look the same. They weigh the same. You really couldn't tell them apart. One's worth billions of dollars. One's worth a few cents. The only difference is the information, the meaningful information. And so I think that it should not surprise us that as unique beings, the unique hybrids of the material and the spiritual, of the dust of the earth and the breath of God, that it would be at that intersection that wealth and value would be created. And I think you see that in every development, in every creative activity, but I think you see it in abundance of information technology.
I'm currently taking a artificial intelligence for robotics class at Georgia Tech. Are you familiar with Sebastian Brun from Google?
Yes, absolutely.
he's the instructor. I'm just curious.
Yes.
Just real curious. In how long do you think it'll be before half of the cars on the roads are driverless?
Well, I think, okay, so I think that we drive cars for more reasons than just getting from A to B. And so what I think will happen is that those uses of cars that are just for transport, right? So if you have a truck that you love, you might drive it to work, but you also like to drive your truck, right? It's just like when you buy coffee. You might think that, well, buying coffee is just drinking coffee. Well, that's not true, because if it were true, you would just go to Dairy Queen and get 25-cent coffee. Instead, you spend $5 on coffee at Starbucks, right? There's more going on. You're involved in a coffee-related experience. And so what I think is going to happen with driving is that those uses of cars and trucks and buses that are just people getting transported from one place to the other, so commuting within a city to work, those are going to become autonomous very quickly. I think that, you know, driving your Corvette or something like that will continue for a long time. So I'd expect commercial uses to be autonomous before private uses. And then what will happen is that technology will become more and more standard in ordinary cars that you buy, and will just slowly get used to it. That's what I would expect to happen. But I don't like to put numbers on that, but I will tell you that Uber already has a fleet of Volvo XC90s driving autonomously in Pittsburgh, and Tesla already has trucks that can do this. So it's not like this is some crazy future technology that exists already. It's more a matter of kind of socialization and getting used to integrating it into our economy, into traffic and things like that.
I'm kind of surprised that maybe there will be warnings, like eventually, if you're driving in this area, you have to acknowledge that 10% of the cars may be driverless. The person right next to you, there may be no driver.
Well, that's right. But so what's happening with Google is that they are holding back. Remember, they've got millions and millions of miles banked. But they decided, because remember, driverless cars don't have to be perfect. They just have to be better than what? Human drivers. We're terrible. And so that's the baseline. But even if they're 20% better, everybody's going to see the story about the robot car that killed someone on drugs, right? Even if 50 people got killed otherwise. And so what Google is doing is they're being very risk averse, and they're waiting until their cars are way better. And so that's actually what's happening generally right now. And so that's why I expect this to be kind of a slow dribble of these technologies. And so you'll go to Washington, D.C. in 2 or 3 years, and there will be some regular routes that used to be buses that will be autonomous vans and things like that, and then it'll work itself out. And we'll just be used to it. Nobody freaks out when they go to the DFW airport and gets on an autonomous shuttle train, for instance. That's what, expect that. But it's going to take place at, it's going to take place at the speed of our kind of psychological comfort, and no faster, hopefully.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay, well, we've had high tech and robots, but we've also had Aristotle, Thomas Aquinas, and Shakespeare in this presentation. It's been very good for me, at least. I hope you've all enjoyed it as well. Let's thank Dr. Richards once again. Thank you all for being here. Have a great day. We discussed.